death is final. Or is it? Countless people have died and then come back to life. What they recount after their near-death experience is often eerily similar regardless of the circumstances. These phenomena may provide a glimpse into the afterlife, or according to some scientists, they may be something else entirely. Around 9 million people in the United States alone have been recorded as having a near-death experience. This often changed the way they thought about life and how they interacted with the world around them. The craziest thing of all is the commonalities between these unconnected events. Someone is considered clinically dead by medical professionals when their heart stops beating. However, with advances in medical technology, just because someone is dead doesn't mean they can't be brought back to life. Thanks to defibrillators and CPR, someone can have their heart restarted several minutes after it stopped beating. This is what we consider a near-death experience. During this time, some pretty wild common occurrences happen. Many people have recounted seeing a bright light or have an out-of-body experience. Oftentimes, they watch what's going on in the operating room or hear conversations that they were technically dead for. However, there's also a more sinister side to the near-death experiences, a darker common occurrence of feeling deep despair and loneliness, as well as a spooky-looking female apparition can occur. What causes these commonalities and why doesn't everyone recover from death? What is a near-death experience actually? Scientists are now closer to answering these questions than ever before. The first near-death experience described in a medical report came from a military doctor in northern France. Named Pierre-Jean de Monchot in 1740, the patient had too much blood drawn while doctors tried to treat an intense fever. In the report, the patient said he saw such a pure and extreme light that he thought he was in heaven. Even the first medical record of a near-death experience includes a bright light. But is it God, or is there another explanation? Dr. Sam Parnia, an associate professor at NYU Grossman School of Medicine, has been pushing the boundaries of what we once thought of as death. His research focuses on when death actually occurs. He's found that cells inside your body don't die when your heart stops, but may last up to 10 hours after. He's hypothesized that if we understand what consciousness is and the connections between all of the cells in our body, we may be able to bring back people to life long after they've been declared clinically dead. His research has also led to other findings, especially in explaining what a near-death experience could be. Parnia believes that someone's consciousness continues long after the brain and heart shut down completely. This may account for certain common experiences people have when they die and are brought back to life. Parnia sees thoughts and consciousness as being fundamentally different from synaptic activity. He claims that there's no evidence that shows how brain cells could generate thoughts. So for right now, we're working within the constraints of what we can know based on the technology we have. But if thoughts and consciousness lie somewhere else in the body, this may explain why near-death experiences occur. If consciousness continues on after the body is dead, then perhaps that's why, even though there's no brain activity, people have still vivid visions or able to even recount things that happened around them while they were dead. However, other scientists are a little more skeptical and have a different explanation for what near-death experiences could be. Kevin Nelson, a neurologist at the University of Kentucky Medical Center, provides a less mystifying explanation for near-death experiences. Nelson claims that many of the visions, out-of-body experiences, and lights associated with near-death experiences can also be triggered when someone isn't in any danger of dying at all. This may indicate that the things people go through during near-death experiences aren't necessarily connected to the event itself, but to normal activity of the human nervous system. The commonalities that people recount during their near-death experiences also seem to be similar to those that happen when someone faints. Nelson suggests that it may not be the threat of death that causes the experiences, but the feeling of being threatened itself. Conducting experiments in the safe conditions of a laboratory was shown to generate similar experiences as in near-death patients. A study from 1994 found that fainting caused the participants in the experiment to feel at peace, entering another plane, and being surrounded by light. All of these things are also associated with near-death experiences. The scientists found that out-of-body experiences were not only common in fainting trials, but in the general population as a whole. In one study of 13,000 people, researchers found that almost 6% of them had an out-of-body experience. So it would appear that this type of event is not reserved for those who have had a brush with death. If this is the case, then what about all the other near-death experiences? If they can be explained by natural processes of the body, then scientists would be in a better position to explain why certain events occur when someone dies and then is brought back to life. For example, out-of-body experiences are also commonly reported by people with epilepsy or who go through sleep paralysis. Since the latter is non-life-threatening, it stands to reason that the near-death experience is not causing the out-of-body experience, but something else may be. Nelson has conducted research where, by using a small electrical charge to zap someone's temporoparietal cortex, which is the part of the brain that regulates how the body perceives itself, out-of-body experiences can be triggered. But Nelson thinks that the events which occur during near-death experiences can be explained by something all of us do each night. A lot of the things that people see during a near-death experience can also occur when someone transitions between wakefulness and the rapid eye movement stages of sleep. Nelson believes that the key characteristics of near-death experiences are all normal things that occur during a sudden shift in states of awareness. This is called the borderland of consciousness, the switch that controls when we change between states of consciousness like wakefulness and REM sleep. Is housed deep within the brainstem. Nelson hypothesizes that when someone undergoes a near-death event like a cardiac arrest, the brain malfunctions. When this happens, the different states of consciousness may begin to bleed together, which could cause the person to undergo several of the things associated with near-death experiences. It isn't so much that the person is seeing beyond this life, as their perception of reality is being merged together with multiple levels of consciousness. This idea is called the REM intrusion theory. Nelson even takes it a step further by explaining why the bright light during a near-death experience is so common. When the brain switches between wakefulness and REM sleep, it's actually activating part of the visual system. So it's logical that when someone passes through the borderland of consciousness, they would experience some form of light. This wouldn't be a light from the great beyond, but instead a byproduct of the brain switching back and forth between consciousness levels and accidentally activating the visual system of the body. But not all scientists believe that near-death experiences can be explained away by malfunctioning brainstems and the bleeding of consciousness levels. Bruce Grayson, who is a psychiatrist at the University of Virginia, has been studying near-death experiences for almost 50 years. He claims that the REM intrusion theory cannot explain every near-death experience. The most concrete example of this is in people who have near-death experiences while under conditions that inhibit their brain from going into REM sleep. This happens, for example, when someone is given anesthesia. The biggest problem that Grayson has with the REM intrusion theory is that some data just doesn't support it. He even acknowledges that REM intrusion theory seems plausible for explaining near-death experiences, but the information available and the data that's been collected does not make sense if the slipping between consciousness levels is the sole reason for all near-death experiences. One of the most significant examples for Grayson that has him believing that there is more to near-death experiences than just blending of consciousness levels actually comes from his own work. He'd been trying to revive a patient who had overdosed on drugs and was clinically dead. When he and his team were able to revive her, the patient was able to recall precise details from what was happening while she was dead. The patient repeated back a conversation that Grayson had with her roommate in the next room over, and that Grayson had spaghetti sauce on his tie while he was trying to revive her. After he had talked to the patient, he concluded that the only way it could have happened was if she had left her body, and that made no sense to me at all. Grayson does not believe the REM intrusion theory can explain this example of a near-death experience with every detail that the patient remembered. What it comes down to is that more research needs to be done, but there are two camps when explaining near-death experiences. The first is that when someone dies and is brought back to life, there's a malfunction in the brain that switches it between different consciousness levels. This can cause hallucinations and, as Nelson believes, can explain almost all of the commonalities between near-death experiences. On the other hand, scientists like Parnia and Grayson think there is more to near-death experiences than that. They're not saying that people are experiencing God or that they're getting a glimpse of the afterlife, but that there's a part of consciousness that we don't quite understand yet. Either way, people who have gone through a near-death experience normally have some type of transformation. Whether it's seeing a bright light, having an out-of-body experience, or something more sinister, like experiencing agony or deep loneliness, something happens. More often than not, people come out of a near-death experience having a new perspective on life, one that actually drives them to be more thankful and more caring for others. Whether this is a result of altered states of consciousness or glimpses into what awaits us in the afterlife is inconsequential to survivors of near-death experiences. Just being alive is a gift to them. Scientists, on the other hand, are driven to explain things. It's what they do. The phenomena associated with near-death experiences most likely will be understood at some point. It just may be after we've moved on to whatever comes after this existence. Now check out Best Evidence of Life After Death, or watch What Happens to You Just Before You Die.